Hi everyone, my name is Stephanie and I want to thank you so much for joining our webinar today, A Simple Online Marketing Plan for Nonprofit Year-End Success. As a nonprofit, I'm sure you know the next few months are really a prime opportunity for you to set your organization up for success so you can hit your year-end fundraising goals. Online marketing and donations can certainly play a role in your success this year. And let's just take a look at some stats here really quick. The percentage of online giving is continuing to grow every year, with 8.7% of total fundraising stemming from online giving just in 2020. And last year also, it was estimated that 26% of online donations were made using mobile devices. Let's take a look at some stats that are more specific to the year-end giving. We see that last year on Giving Tuesday, $511 million was raised, and that was a 28% increase from the year before. In total, about 30% of online giving occurs in the month of December, with just 10% in the last 3 days of the year. So it's a really important time in some areas you want to focus your planning around. With all of that in mind, now is certainly the time to set up a plan that's going to keep you on track through the busy season while still getting the word out about your cause. Now, today we're going to be sharing some great ideas to help you keep your marketing on track through this busy giving season. And that way you'll be one of the organizations that has a plan in place that's going to help you to get the word out about your cause so that you can stay top of mind with supporters, and you'll be using a variety of marketing tools and channels that we're going to be talking about today. With that in mind, let's go ahead and see more specifically what we're going to talk about in today's session. We're going to start by talking about how to prepare for our key giving opportunities this year and put a plan in place. Then we're going to talk about how to take action on that year-end marketing plan and the tools that you'll want to use to accomplish that. And then last but not least, we're going to talk about how to prepare for ongoing success after the holiday season is over. Before we get into all the details, allow me to just go ahead and introduce myself and my guest speaker for today. My name is Stephanie French, and I'm the content manager for webinars here at Constant Contact. And I've been here for a little over 10 years, and I'm excited to share all of my knowledge about online marketing with you. I'm very excited to also bring back and introduce Michele Hickey, the founder of Silver Lining Communications. Now, a while back, she actually joined us to talk about the foundations of online marketing for nonprofits. And today, she's really here to share her knowledge more specifically on year-end fundraising. You want to say a quick hello, Michele?
I would love to. Hi, Stephanie. I'm thrilled to be here. I've been working with nonprofit organizations for 30 years, mainly in fund development and marketing, and I'm just happy to give any information, experience, expertise that I can to your audience today.
Awesome. Thanks again so much for joining us. I know you shared a lot of great information this time, and I'm sure you're going to have tons of great information today. So let's go ahead and dive in. Let's start to talk about planning for some key giving opportunities this year. One of the first things I really want to suggest that you do when preparing for your year-end marketing is to mark some key giving days on your calendar. Now, of course, you're going to want to think about some traditional holidays that typically will spur people into action to give or support your organization. And then there's some other big giving days that we see here. You've got Thanksgiving, Giving Tuesday, which is a really big one for a lot of you. Then, of course, the traditional holidays like Christmas, Kwanzaa, and then New Year's Eve, which falls into that big last 3 days of the year that you want to pay attention to. Another thing I think you should think about is other days that are going to be relevant to your local area. I actually live in Colorado, and I know we have a day here that's called Colorado Gives Day, and that falls on December 8th for us this year. So what I want to suggest that you do is just go out and Google or do a little bit of research and see if there are any other local holidays or giving days that are going to be important for you in getting people to take action and getting the word out about your cause. Now, also in your planning process, you're going to want to sit down and you're going to want to do a little work with your lists. What I mean by this is you want to start by sending targeted, relevant messages, because that's going to be one of the best ways to communicate your audience and really get the right messaging to them that's going to spur that action from them. What this means is segmenting them into smaller groups so that you can customize the messaging for each of them. Now, there's a ton of ways that I can imagine in my mind for a nonprofit to go about this, but what are some examples of segments that would be important to year-end giving specifically?
Well, I think we had talked, Stephanie, you and I, about looking at level of support, recency and frequency, volunteers and board members. Those are all important groups. Also pay attention to what, it's going to sound industry jargony, but LIBUNTS and SIBUNTS. LIBUNT is an acronym for last year, but not this year. And SIBUNT is some year, but not this year. Take a look at that because it's really important to do all you can to retain donors. I mean, we talk a lot about acquiring new donors, but retaining donors is a very efficient and effective way to stabilize your donor base. So you want to look at who has lapsed, and end of year is a great time to do that. Some other things you can take a look at are purpose of past giving, so that you might want to segment your market. You know, if somebody gave to a scholarship versus a program, you know, you want to make sure you're speaking to people about what interests them. That is sort of what motivates them. Look for patterns in giving. This is another thing that you can kind of pull the data. If someone gave the same amount for 3 years running, it might be time to ask for them to think about an increase at the end of the year, you know, when people tend to be feeling very generous. You can segment and slice and dice your data so many ways these days, which is a great thing. But you do want to take a look at what patterns you see. And those would be some of the ones that I would want to take a look at.
I love that because, you know, the patterns really considering why they're giving in the first place, mm-hmm. and that that way you can customize your messaging, which we'll talk about here in a few minutes.
Also, and something else too to think about, when it comes to patterns, if somebody's been increasing their donation for the last couple of years, it might be a good time to pull them from your email and direct mail campaign and try a more personal outreach, like a phone call or trying to sit down with a person-to-person visit. So keep that in mind also.
Yeah, definitely. When it comes to retaining donors, really making it feel personable, mm-hmm. and connecting with them to continue to retain them as a donor. Right. I love that. Now, ideally, you're going to want to sync your donor management software with your Constant Contact account, and that's going to make syncing all of your contacts in there and making the segmentation process a lot easier for you. We actually have integrations with Donor Perfect, Network for Good, and many more, and you're going to be able to find all of these within the integrations tab right at the top of your account when you're logged in. You can just go in there, and then it'll walk you through setting it up in order to sync all of the information and make your life so much easier. So up next is to really sit down and plan the specifics for your year-end fundraising campaign and thinking about any of the goals that you have. I like to think about this in three steps. First up is setting your goal. What I'd like for you to do here is sit down, put a number on what you want to achieve. Do you want to increase your donations by X amount based on what you did last year, or put a dollar amount on it? Next up, understanding your supporters and why they support your cause, or even what inspires them to support your cause in the first place. And lastly, I think it really comes down to understanding and determining your value. That means thinking about who really benefits from the funds that you're collecting and how their donation is going to end up making a difference. Now, in the resources for the webinar, you're going to find the fundraising playbook, and there's a worksheet in there that actually has some detailed questions that you'll want to think about for each of these three steps. So be sure to download that and print it out so that you can write all that out and figure out the specifics for your campaign. That really leads us into this next part, is really determining what our campaign is going to be all about. We'll be able to start to think about the messaging that we're going to use to communicate with our audience as well. Michele, would you be able to share some examples of your clients' year-end campaigns that you've done in the past or maybe working on this year?
Sure. And really, you know, there are as many opportunities as your imagination and creativity can design. But some Typically, successful ones are an end-of-year challenge gift where, you know, you have a donor who commits to giving a certain amount based on what the rest of the community donates. And that's always a fun way to kind of get people inspired. You can do a competition or a contest. You can invite people to donate in honor of someone or in memory of someone. That's another great, you know, end of year, or actually that can happen any time of the year. A lot of organizations that I've worked with over the years use a grateful client approach at the end of the year. In fact, I just prepared a letter for an education organization that the letter is signed by, or the email communication is signed by a graduate of their program. And it was really, it turned out to be a very heartfelt letter. We haven't sent it yet, so I can't tell you exactly how successful it's going. It is, but I think it's going to do really well because it's really very sincere and it really speaks to why the organization is important.
I love that point about sincerity, and that's something that would really draw me in. A lot of what we're going to be talking about as we go through today is bringing people in and connecting with them on an emotional level. And I love that as a great example for the campaign itself. So at this point in the planning process, it's time to think a little bit more about the campaign's overall messaging. And in general, we like to break it down into three questions that you want to ask yourself that's going to help you to write a compelling message. And you can use these in any of the channels that we're going to talk about today. So first up, let's talk about the headline. Here, you're going to want to ask yourself, what are you trying to accomplish? This is where you really want to pique their interest enough to draw them in and continue to read more about what your campaign is and what you're trying to get them to do. The second question is for the message body. Why should the reader care? This is where you want to elaborate on the problem that you're trying to solve with your campaign and provide some details on why they really matter to your reader. Then for your call to action, this is where you want to answer how can the reader get involved, and you want to be really specific with this. This is where you want to invite your audience to take part in solving the problem and really helping your cause overall. This simple formula, like I said, it can help you to come up with the messaging that you'll use in a variety of the different channels we'll talk about today. The thing I want to mention is you'll have your overall messaging, but you will need to adjust it slightly depending on the channel. You know, for social media, that messaging is going to be quick and simple, so you'll just want to adjust it slightly. So along those same lines, and you've briefly mentioned it before, Michele, is to really have an understanding of why people are donating this time of year, and that's going to help you to adjust your messaging even more. Could you share some insight with us on why or the motives that people typically have?
Sure. Well, I think the end of year holiday season tends to just inspire that feeling of generosity and people wanting to feel connected to the world around them in a positive way. People want to feel like they're making a difference in the world. I think that's a very natural, you know, human thing for everyone to feel. There is also the idea that, well, you can get your tax deduction in. But honestly, you know, if you speak with enough donors and fund development professionals, that's somewhat low on the list, for most donors. Not that it's, you know, never a consideration, but I think the other aspects tend to be more of what pull people toward being generous. People want to be connected to something positive, something that's having a real impact in their community or in the sector or field that they're interested in. Also consider that some religious traditions advocate giving, so that, you know, if that is part of your audience, that might be something to bring into the conversation. But, you know, it's often said that the number one reason that people give, it's because that they're asked. So going back to that last slide where you talk about, you know, make the call to action, don't shy away from it. It's not that you need to hammer people over the head with it, but you have to be direct. You know what I'm saying? You have to hammer people over there, but you do have to be direct and clear and make it easy for people to make that contribution. And also too, when you have your Give Now button, play it through to see how directly it gets to the gift to the transaction. You know, if somehow you've filtered in too many clicks, you know, you could lose people that way. You know, if they get frustrated, you know, and you don't want that to happen, you want to go right to the point.
Exactly. You don't want to drive people to your homepage,
No.
then they have to find your button, and then they have to get into the donation
Yep.
flow.
Yep.
Drive them exactly to the form where they're going to fill it out, choose how much, put in
Exactly.
their payment information and all of that. That is a great point and so, so important in online marketing. So I wanted to share a few other ideas to keep in mind as you're crafting your campaign messaging and going throughout today. I wanted to share this piece of advice, this quote that I found. It's from John Hayden. He says, "Don't ask people to donate. Instead, ask them to join, build, etc. Appeal to their identity and emotion, not their wallets." And I really love that because as we start to think about crafting a message, and it really is all about them and wanting to feel like they're making a difference. So this is where in your messaging, you're going to want to start to use terms like you and your.
Mm-hmm.
And in channels like email marketing, where you have the ability to include a greeting tag in their name, make sure you're doing that so it starts out with hello or dear Michelle or dear Stephanie. So that way it really starts to feel like a personal message to them. And then start to pull in individual stories and compelling examples of how their donation is going to make an impact. A little bit later on, we'll have Michelle talk more about this in a little bit greater detail on choosing stories and writing great stories for your messaging. And then last but not least, this is where you want to, like Michelle said, keep your messaging simple and focused. Don't try to throw too many stats or information in an email or a post because that can feel overwhelming to people. And then that can start to kind of distract from what your message is about, of you making the ask and wanting them to donate. Michelle, do you have any other tips when it comes to thinking about the overall campaign messaging?
I think, and by the way, join and build are great. I see a lot of investment and return on investment in fundraising pieces in the last couple of years. So that's another one to keep in mind. But make sure you're tapping into the power of video, audio, and graphics. Those three types of communication can help you get the data across in a much more digestible way.
I love that. And video and audio can play into all of the different channels we're going to be talking about today.
Yes, and Constant Contact, brings the video in it's so beautifully. It really just makes it a pleasure to incorporate that into the communications.
Yep, it's very simple to go in and add that link to your email campaign. All right, so now that you've got some ideas for your year-end campaign and your messaging, let's move on to actually getting your audience to take action and really putting that message out there so that you can reach the right people. As I mentioned before, a variety of online marketing tools can and should be playing a role in your strategy, and they should be working together in order for your organization to reach success. Now, you're going to want to use your website. That's going to serve as the home base for your activities, and you'll be linking back to it from all of these other channels in a lot of cases. Listings and reviews, it's just another way that people are going to find your organization. Social media is going to help you to keep people informed and spread the word about your campaign. And then, of course, email marketing, because you can reach people directly in their inbox, share the information about your cause and your year-end campaign. And then, of course, content. This is another way that you're going to be able to get found, but also provide more value to your constituents. That's going to be big and play a role through any of these channels as well. And then last but not least, paid ads. This is going to be another way to help you amplify your efforts. And don't discount me yet if you're thinking, I don't have the budget for that. There's some options there, and it can actually be pretty cost effective in a lot of cases if you're looking to grow your email list. So stick with me as we go through and talk about that as well. So let's dive in and let's start with the website, and we'll start talking about each of these and how to take action for that year-end plan. Like I said, your website is really there to serve as a home base so people can find out more about you, your cause, and this is where you'll be linking back to from all of these other channels that we just showed you. And it's important to really adjust your website to highlight your year-end fundraising campaign. What other tips do you have to make sure our audience's website is ready for this time of year?
Well, on a website, you can, sometimes people don't let me put it this way. There are different opinions about it, but if you're doing a short-term end of your push, you could do a pop-up. that came up just perfectly in time with what I was thinking. Yeah, you can do a nice little pop-up for, you know, a limited period of time. I would just make sure that you set it so that, you know, you limit how many times it pops up. Usually there are settings where, you know, it will only come up once every time somebody opens your website, so that it's just, you know, you don't want it to become an irritant. But that's a great thing to do. Obviously, you know, year round, you want to have your donate button on every page and your sign up form on every page. But that would be a suggestion. You can also do, do a special homepage revision, which has, you know, maybe some of the videos that you'll be featuring in your email campaign and social media, you know, so that you can change it up a little bit to kind of catch people's eye and catch their attention.
Definitely. I love the points about having a donate on every page so that it's easy to find if you haven't linked someone directly there or they just find you from a search. And the thing I want to point out with a sign up form, you can, like Michele said, add a pop-up form to your website. It's a great way to catch their attention, and you can do that within your constant contact account. But when you're creating a sign-up form or at any point in the process where you're asking people to join your mailing list, don't just focus on getting them on your mailing list and for them to receive your email. It's not about that. It's about them knowing the value that they're going to get by receiving your organization's email. So you've got to show them value that's in it for them. And this, I think, really goes back to that quote that we just talked about earlier, where you want to invite them to join you to build something or whatever your goal is with the cause and what you're trying to accomplish there. So the second tool that I want to talk about today is listings and reviews. And if you think about it, potential supporters can find you from a search like this, but potential supporters are also going to use these sites. I've done it myself. They're going to vet whether your organization is legit and worthy of their support with you. So you want to make sure you've got some listings out there on some of these main sites. They need to have some accurate information, and they need to have some reviews of people saying good things and how great you are for the community and the work that you do. So you're going to want to make sure you're listed on some of these top sites like Facebook, Google My Business, Yelp, GuideStar.org, and Charity Navigator, which Michele and I talked about those in a higher level in the previous webinar we did, which we'll be linking to those in the resources as well. What are some other important things to think about as our audience is preparing for year-end giving and thinking of these listing and review sites?
Well, I think the most important thing is to just make sure you've got a handle on everywhere that your organization appears. First of all, you know, do the best you can to get your arms around the different places where people are encountering your organization online, and making sure that the basic information is correct. I mean, you don't want a broken link to your website. You want to make sure that the hours appear consistently, you know, and that's especially been important this last year as people are phasing in and phasing out, you know, shutting down, opening back up. Make sure that everything is consistent, and make sure that there is accurate contact information, you know, that someone can actually reach a person, you know, with reasonable effort. As far as, say, GuideStar.org, I think, you know, it's to your benefit, since it's free, to maintain your profile on GuideStar. If your organization files a tax return every year, then you're already listed on GuideStar, so you may as well claim that space and, you know, populate it as thoroughly as you can. It's really a mark of transparency for your organization. And, you know, you can actually earn badges for how much information you include. So, you know, that becomes another thing to promote. You could invite people to give in honor of your new platinum, you know, GuideStar.org badge if you like. But it's certainly a nice little promotional element for your organization.
And I really liked your point there about transparency, because that's really what these sites in particular are there to provide, the information, and makes people feel comfortable donating to you or volunteering with your organization. And I know I've done that many times in the past, whether I want to work with them to adopt my next pet or really just to give them some money for the year-end fundraising. So the next channel I want to talk about is actually social media. Social media is really going to play a role in helping you to reach new people and also communicating with existing followers. On a very basic level, like Michele was just talking about with listings and reviews, you want to make sure your profile information is also updated with the right contact information, as well as hours of operations, because we all know that this year has been extremely crazy and lots of things have changed. So just make sure that information is correct. Now, in the past, Michele and I have talked about different types of social posts, and we've talked about them or thinking about them in three buckets typically: awareness, engagement, and then of course driving action. Driving action is of course where it comes into donating or them volunteering to support your cause. Michele, can you talk a little bit more specifically about a strategy here and some of the other types of posts that they might want to think about in order to support their campaigns?
Well, I think as your campaign moves along, one of a great type of post is the thank you post. I think you can you can plan out some internal thank yous from grateful clients, but you can also post donor responses. You know, you can reach out to people and thank them for their donation and say, hey, would you like to post, you know, something on our Facebook page about why you donated? And I think that can be a nice dialogue to add.
Definitely. And so a lot of what we're talking about today is sharing valuable information that just supports the mission and what you're trying to do. So, you know, educating, those success stories that you're talking about. You can even share some behind the scenes of you preparing, a meal, a Thanksgiving meal or something like that. And that's actually a great tie-in to my next part here, is before you mentioned about video, and imagery and videos are huge in social media, email, really anywhere online. Now, what tips do you have for creating some relevant videos and actually choosing some great imagery to support these posts?
Well, I mean, just looking at the list you posted, I mean, and I do love the behind the scenes element, because I think people just love that. You know, if you're supporting a theater, how much fun is it to see what goes on backstage? If it's in, we were talking about the aquarium, my daughter has worked in an aquarium and she works at a zoo, and I'm getting all these behind the scenes pictures just from her, and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, donors would just love to see this. It is so much fun. Yes. So those are the kind of things that it really just requires looking around and trying to see what you're seeing with an outsider's eyes, what's become commonplace to you and feels like it's just part of every day, could be really, really interesting to somebody who, only sees the other side of what you're doing.
I would love to see more of that in the organizations I support. And along those same lines, thinking about video, I actually recently saw a post from an animal sanctuary that I follow here in Colorado. And they're actually running a competition. They've started, the promotions for it now. And they're encouraging people to post videos of themselves for Colorado Gives Day, videos on why they support the organization
and why they love it so much.
Exactly. Yeah. And then there, it sounds like on Colorado Gives Day, they're going to choose a winner who the money's going to go to, but that money is actually going to be donated in the winner's name to the care of all of the animals, which sounds so exciting to me. So I think this is just another way that you can encourage user-generated content like this and include the video, which is so powerful in today's world. So there are, like we were just talking about, there are several things that you're going to want to post on your social media channels. Those kind of in a roundabout way support your campaign. Now, when you're directly promoting your campaign and asking people to donate, we typically think about it in a series of three posts. First, you want to announce your campaign. Then you want to remind people, and then a last chance reminder right before it ends. Now, I would typically start running these posts at least 2 weeks out. You could do it as far as a month out or maybe even a little more depending on how long your campaign is planning to run. So if we want the end date of our campaign on Giving Tuesday or the end of the year, at least 2 weeks before that. And then the reminder post could be posted at least 1 week before it ends. And then the last chance reminder could go a day or two before. Although I've actually seen a lot of nonprofits lately, they're doing multiple last chance reminders. So maybe starting 3 days out from the end date, last chance, or, you know, don't forget about this, and so on and so forth. Now, of course, there are those other types of posts that we talked about as well, which brings up a popular question we get. How often should our audience be posting on social media?
Well, I mean, I don't see anything wrong with a daily post. And maybe two, depending on what you're posting. I think probably no more than a daily post if it's a fundraising post, you know, because you might want to do another post during the day that's really more program related. But I would think that would be the higher end that I would recommend. What I would recommend, though, is building a team of insiders, people that are close to your organization that you know are very active on social media and hopefully have large groups of connections and followers, and ask them as part of your campaign strategy, ask them to repost, reshare what you're posting, because that will push your message out beyond your own little internal group. And what you could do, I mean, if you don't want to do sort of the ask with every single post, you can do regular success posts, success / thank you posts. So in between your announcement and your reminder, you can do a couple of posts like, oh, we're up to this point today. Almost like the old thermometers that you would, you know, you could do the social media version of the thermometer to let people know how the campaign is going.
I love that, because it's kind of like a competition in my mind, because I'm rooting for this organization, right, and I want them to reach their goal. Yeah. So then I'm more likely to share that. So I love that point about all of it. Thank you. Now, what I want to point out is you can use Constant Contact to collect your donations. We've actually got an action block within our email marketing tool that you can create a landing page for. But Facebook has its own donation tools, and I really like this, because if you think about it, a lot of your supporters are likely already visiting Facebook at least on a daily basis. If you're like some people I know, they're actually logging in multiple times a day and staying up to date with everything that's happening. So it can be a really good idea to set up Facebook's charitable giving tools, if I can get that out right. Facebook's charitable giving tools, so that they can donate directly without having to leave Facebook or anything like that. Now, we've actually got a blog that has been written on the Constant Contact blog, so be sure to check that out in the resources if you're learning on how to set this up. As you'll see based on this screenshot, there is some information you have to submit, and then it takes a couple of weeks to get reviewed before you can start collecting that information. But definitely something to think about, because it's right there and a lot of people are ready and willing to donate, especially with birthday fundraisers and things like that. So the fourth tool I want to talk about today is actually email marketing. Email still has one of the best returns on investment out there, and this is how you're going to reach people directly in their inbox. I love email marketing because you don't have to rely on social media algorithms like you do in the other channels and simply just hope and pray that your followers see it. There's really a lot that you can accomplish with email marketing, and you're going to have the ability to promote your campaign. And this is such a great way to build relationships with people, keep them informed and really excited about your progress, which is really kind of what we were talking about with social media as well. Now, how would you suggest, what tips do you have for our audience to write great fundraising emails?
Well, I often caution, you know, a lot of the nonprofit world, they are still tied to the idea of these longer newsletters. And I really advise against it. I think people just don't have the bandwidth to read a lengthy newsletter. So I think you're better off maybe emailing more frequently and just breaking that information up into more digestible pieces. But yeah, you've got to be engaging. You've got to be direct. I see that in your notes there. And I think that's great. Make it visually appealing. Again, using the great tools, the read more, the the video tool. I think all of those things are there to support your message. And also think about where and how you're linking. It's tempting to link to resources outside your organization, and that sometimes is the best thing to do. But when you're trying to raise money, you're trying to drive traffic to your website, to your giving page. So just, you know, think through, and again, making it easy for the person reading the email to get over to that donation page.
I can't agree more with your comments about, you know, the newsletters and then the, you know, getting people to donate. Mm-hmm. You know, the newsletter is still fine if you find the need and the want and people are going to read it to do like once a month or whatever your cadence is. But when you're asking for donations, you know, you can really start to draw people in by keeping it one email focused just on your campaign and the fact that you're asking for a donation. You know, typically what we say, like Michele said, keep it simple. I like to think about it as you need a picture, a paragraph, and a call to action in order to get people to take that action. So you've talked a little bit more about maybe sending, splitting that newsletter up and sending multiple emails. How often do you suggest our nonprofits mail over the holiday season?
I would think no more than 3 times a week. And even that, I mean, you got to watch your, you know, your unsubscribes. You know, I have one client and they do literally an email a week. And I started to see a few unsubscribes and I got a little nervous. I'm keeping an eye on it. You know, you don't want people dropping out just because they're like, and we all feel it. You know, you're like, oh my God, I can't deal with this inbox anymore. So you want to be sensitive to that. So that would be my advice. Just keep an eye on your unsubscribes and kind of try to tailor it to where you feel that your sweet spot is in terms of how often.
Definitely, and pay attention to your open rates, which you'll have access to in your constant contact account, and most importantly, your click rates. If you see your open and your click rates going down and your unsubscribes going up, that can definitely serve as a red flag that you might be mailing too much.
Yeah.
So good point there. So as we said with social media, I do want to point out, you know, as Michele was talking, you can send multiple emails. You can use that same type of cadence and reminders to remind people. You know, you can set up email one as announcement, email two to remind them, email three as a last chance reminder to donate. And something else to think about there is you can always use email to say thank you. We're talking about a lot about cadence here, and some people are like, well, I don't want to mail too frequently over the holidays. So just make sure you're paying attention to all of your reporting information. But this information can be helpful, or this cadence can be helpful, because you working for a nonprofit are extremely busy over the holidays with your resources limited. Me as a donor, I'm pretty busy over the holidays and really year round as well. So I can get your first email and I might get distracted by my son saying something. And then I actually just forget about it and I forget to go back. So those additional emails and even those additional social media posts, that's just another opportunity to remind myself and actually get in there and donate so that I can hopefully do it the next time. So don't be afraid of emailing too much, but keep an eye on all of the stats. So another big part of email marketing is the email list. And organizations want to know all the time, how do they grow their email list? So a couple of examples we talked about already, add a form to your website, make sure you're doing that. You can use social media. What you can do in constant contact is create a lead generation landing page to collect their email address, maybe their first name. And then you can, once you publish that, you can share the link to the page on your social media pages. What are some other ways that you're seeing nonprofits actually get people on their list, Michele?
Well, a lot of organizations that I've worked with make good use of the text to join feature in Constant Contact, where you can set up a number that you know, an individual interested in your organization can send a text and it leads them right to the email sign-up page. That can happen. You know, I've often promoted that at public events. We're not doing so many public events, but a lot of people are doing Zoom events. And so it's perfectly appropriate and a great idea to put that information up. You can do special drives with your volunteers and with your current people on your list to ask them to share it with some, you know, the sign up page with a friend. You know, that's another great way to use your volunteer network. Another thing that I've used, if you're a small organization, a community organization, or maybe even a bigger one, but if you use print materials, what I've also helped organization do is to create a QR code that leads right to the email signup page. So that is, if you're not familiar with a QR code, it's one of those little square digital codes that people can read with a scanner on their phone. And that's been a very effective tool for driving traffic to the email signup page.
Yeah, so there's a lot of ways that you can actually go in and set these up within Constant Contact. I just wanted to call out the text to join feature because last time we talked about it, a lot of people didn't seem to know about it. So I wanted to kind of show how it works.
Yeah,
so right within your account, you're going to start by turning on the feature. You'll set up a keyword and then you're going to get a phone number. In the system, you can print out a standard sign, or you can take that keyword and that phone number to design something else like we see here on the left, something that's a little bit more designed for your needs, especially if you've got a graphic designer who's volunteering their time. Why not take advantage of their services, right? What people are going to do then is they're going to text in that keyword to that phone number. Then they're going to receive a message asking for their email address. And when they reply with their email address, the system is actually going to send a thank you message. Both the hello message and the thank you message, like we see here, those are going to be able to be customized by you so that you can adjust them to fit the verbiage that your organization uses on the regular. So let's talk about the fifth tool, which is actually content. This can play a role in your year-end marketing as well, because you want to create content that's going to help you get found online and also provide value. I think we've talked about this several times already in the other channels. If you think about it, content is what people search for, they consume it, and then they can share it online. And this allows you to drive traffic back from search. Now, this is also something that once you put in the work to say, let's create a post on your blog or something like that, it can start to fuel other areas of your marketing because you can start to share that link to the blog post in your email or on your social channels. And this is really where storytelling can and should be coming into play, which is so important for nonprofits. Can you talk more about how to actually tell a story and how they'll tie that to their year-end giving campaigns?
Well, I think looking around you, just, you know, picking your head up again and looking around and seeing where the stories are is, you know, and it's just a habit that you have to build because you get so caught up in doing what you do, which is important. But people like to hear about the successes of your organization. They want to hear about the student who got a scholarship because of the after-school program that they funded. And even better, if they can hear the word, you know, read the words of the student, or better yet, you know, watch that student in a video talk about how that program helped, you know, that is very compelling. It takes people right to the heart of why they're giving. I think it's important to learn about your cause and to even, in addition to donating, maybe learn how they can be advocates for your cause. And then I love the piece about celebrating donors. I mean, if you think about it, at least in my mind, nobody has to be a donor. This is not a requirement for anybody except, you know, a legally created foundation. The rest of us do not have to be donors, which to me means that everyone who donates, there's a story about why they're making this gift. And it is, I find it endlessly fascinating to learn what that is. And, you know, you just find out the most interesting facts about people and interesting background and motivations. So yeah, celebrate those stories, tell those stories. And you'll find it just yourself digging into to those conversations, you're going to find it so personally rewarding that it's not even going to feel like work.
I love that, the whole point about rewarding and things like that. Stories, I like to think about, you know, when you're telling and finding these stories, stories are really what tell people who you are, who your organization is, what you do, who you're helping, and also how you're accomplishing this, which I think kind of goes back to educating people about your cause in the first place. Because, you know, someone might see a stat or something and then they start researching it. And guess what? If they research it and you've put a piece of content on your blog, that's just another chance that you're going to show up in the search results, which might lead them in to actually being a supporter or becoming a volunteer of your organization. Are there any other types of content that you've seen clients use to drive year-end donations?
Let me think. I do know of one organization that does a competitive end-of-year campaign with different groups, you know, different, it's an education institution, so they do different class years. I think that a lot of organizations right now are doing, it's sort of alongside their end of year campaigns, but I see a lot of impact reports being developed right now, which is in some ways a summary of what has gone on with the program during the year, but it also focuses on the stories of you know, it intersperses with stories of the donors who supported that in the year. I think some of those have come out very nice and are very compelling. And one thing about when you're celebrating donors, one of the values of doing that is that the person who's reading or hearing the story that the donor is telling is going to start identifying with that person. And that is ideal. That is what you want. You want people to sort of feel themselves like, oh, okay, I could be a donor too, and I can make an impact. You know, and that's really the content that inspires people. You know, if people feel like they, you know, their gift, whatever size, is going to make a difference, that will help motivate them to actually make the gift.
I love that, you know, all about kind of just triggering them into action and mm-hmm. all leading back to that whole emotional connection that you're building with people through the content and everything that you're doing in your marketing for your campaign. I love it. So the last tool that we want to talk about today is paid ads. Paid ads is where you want to start to amplify your efforts from those traditional tools that we were just talking about. Amplify your efforts with paid advertising. Now, you have a few options when you're thinking about doing this, and we actually have some really easy to use tools to create ads right within Constant Contact. So I know many of you might feel that maybe you don't have the budget, or maybe you just don't have the experience or the technical expertise in order to do this. I can tell you that I've gone in there and I can actually create ads, whereas I've tried to do it before through traditional platforms, and even being in marketing myself, I wasn't quite sure how to do it. So I assure you, any of you can get an ad out and get the word out about your cause. So there's a couple of different kinds of ads, and you'll see Facebook lead ads there in the middle. This is a great way to help you to grow your email list. You can do it any time of year, but I think especially now as we're starting to lead up to the busy season, now's the perfect time to put an ad out there if you can and get people on your email list. You'll basically pay to reach them once and then they're on your email list and you can communicate to them as many times as you need to. And then there's just regular Facebook and Instagram and even Google ads where you can use it to drive traffic directly to your organization's website, or you might be driving traffic directly for them to donate through the end of the year. A lot of options there. Now, when you're creating ads, it's really important, again, stories. Bring them back to the stories of the people that you're helping to help draw people in. Now, the great thing about social media and even Google Ads is that you're going to have the ability to get really targeted. You're going to be able to find the people who are most likely to support your organization in the first place. So you want to make sure you spend the time to think about your targeting and the options that you have in your tool. Think about your existing supporters and who they are, where they're located, and things like that. With Facebook, you can actually create a custom audience on there. For Facebook and Instagram, you can target by age, gender, and interests. Interests are the things that people have shown. Maybe they've liked a page or they've shown interest in music and things like that. Now, also, if you have a large enough email list, 300 is the lowest amount, but ideally they recommend having 500 contacts on your mailing list. You can create what's called a lookalike audience. This is going to be where you upload your list, and it's going to help you to find people who look a lot like your existing supporters. So when you create your ad, you're pretty much targeting people who should already be interested in supporting your organization. Now, with social ads, of course, you're again going to want to connect with people visually. So that means showing pictures and the videos of the people or the animals that you're helping. Again, an emotional connection. And then when it comes to writing the copy for your ads, considering your headline first, of course, go back to those three questions for your text that we talked about at the beginning. But your headlines for sure need to be actionable. That means you want to use those verbs like we've been talking about, build or join or give, and basically invite them to support your cause. Now, you are going to have some limitations, especially when you're creating an ad. So of course, you want that text to be short and catchy. Now, as with other channels, you really just want to make sure, again, appeal to their emotions and don't just make it about donating to your cause. You've got to connect to them emotionally. I don't think I can say that enough. Talk about why your cause really matters in the first place and make sure you're using some descriptive adjectives in that copy as well. Now, I know some of you are like, we don't have the budget to do this, but I do want to let you know that Google actually has a program that offers qualifying nonprofits Google Ad Grants to help your organization expand your reach. So we've got a blog post that you're going to find in the resources again. So check that out. And then it's got links in there if you find out that you're qualifying, so you can go in and apply to the program. All right, so now that you know how to create your plan and you know how to take action, let's talk about preparing for success after the holidays and into next year. So it's really important after the holidays to sit down and have a plan in place for ongoing success. And I think this all starts with reviewing the results to understand what worked and what didn't. And I know Michele and I have talked a little bit about this earlier. We've got some of them on the screen, but what are some of the other key metrics that you and your clients are paying attention to in order to determine the success of a marketing campaign?
Well, we talked about subscribes and unsubscribes. I think that is a good gauge of how well your list of followers is going. For fundraising, you're also obviously going to be looking at, number of new donors, number of repeat donors, average gift size, number of increased donations. That's really a lot of the point of what you're doing. It's nice to have, all of the followers, but at some point you need to be converting them into donors. So those are some of the fundraising statistics that I would be looking at the end of the year.
Definitely. And you can take all of this information that you're seeing in any of the tools, email, in your fundraising tool, determine. We've talked about segmentation at the beginning, but it's important to continue to segment people so that when you're marketing throughout the year, they can continue to get information that's going to be relevant to them. So, put them in a group based on how they donated or why they donated or any of those other reasons we talked about at the beginning.
Yes, and actually, what you just said too about look at how they're donating, what channel are they using to make their donation, that will give you a lot of important insight as well.
Yeah, think about how they donated in the past so that you can continue to reach them in the future and even provide additional stories and information on your progress. So the next thing that I really want you to think about is that a donation is not the finish line. It's really just the starting point for your organization. And online marketing, you've heard me talk about it throughout today, and even if you watch past webinars, it can help you to build long-lasting relationships with your supporters. It's very, very important. So again, thinking about those segments that you already have and, segmenting with any new data you have, you want to make sure you're saying thank you to those donors. I know Michele has talked about that a ton today.
Thank you many times.
I don't think you can. Yeah. And you can also communicate with those who didn't donate. You might say something like, we miss you. But in that case as well, you might want to show them the progress you were able to make. Maybe they're just waiting on their next progress or their next paycheck, excuse me. Mm-hmm. So when you send that email, you know, kind of letting them know we miss you, that might actually spur them into action. Maybe they have that next paycheck and they're ready to give you a little bit of money. Now, it's also important to, you know, again, thank people, educate people about your cause and everything like that. Those are really just some starting suggestions thinking into the new year. What other ideas do you have for helping nonprofits to plan their marketing in the future?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, a nice little content calendar is a good idea. It doesn't have to be terribly complex. And in fact, in the last email I sent to my audience, I included just a little template that people could use for, you know, the coming year, and it is not too early to plan for that. I think when you're looking at your content calendar, you know, a whole year might be a lot, especially right now with things changing so rapidly, but certainly you can be looking 6 months into the future. My only caveat to that would be is pay attention, because things are changing rapidly all the time. So you may need to pivot. You know, I think this past year, you know, we've all become, you know, masters in pivoting our messages. So, you know, it's sort of have a plan, but, you know, have a plan B, be flexible. I think those are always good rules of thumb to stand by.
Yeah, pivot is the new word of the year, I think, but it's important to plan so that you can stay on track and it's not been 3 months since you've made a social post or sent your email, because waiting that long for between those types of things is not really a good thing. You know, you want to plan for any additional holidays or days in the year that are related to your cause, any events you're planning to hold and things like that, because you definitely want to make sure that you're staying top of mind, and it goes back to providing value and building those relationships.
And consistency. Staying consistent.
Consistency.
Really important.
Exactly. You don't want to send an email 3 months away, because people may have forgotten about you and they might be surprised and they might just unsubscribe or mark your email as spam or just not even pay attention to that. Either way, we don't want that to happen. Now, by the way, you can do all of your planning right within Constant Contact for the holidays and even into the new year. You're actually going to see our new calendar view feature if you go to the campaigns tab, and it'll be kind of on the top left of your page there. You can use it to plan out your email campaigns, your ads, your social media posts, and even your events. What you can do is you can go in and give it a title. You could say like January newsletter or something like that. Click save, go back to planning. And later on, you can go back to your calendar, click on it, and you'll be able to create your actual email campaign, add in your text and your imagery and your videos and all of that. It really will make planning it out at least a month or two in advance will certainly help. Like Michele said, we're in a crazy time in our lives where none of us have experienced this. So we're kind of learning on the fly, but it'll at least keep us on track and give us a reminder to go in and do these things that are going to be good for our organization. All right, so we're at a good point where we can start to wrap up, and I just want to make sure to leave you all with a few reminders as you head into the busy season, because I know you can do it. So make sure you take the time now to plan your year-end giving campaign. It's important to write it down, write down your goals so that you can, again, stay on track. And you want to plan for each of the channels, all of those channels, so that you can be able to promote your campaign and get the word out. You also want to make sure that you're using those foundational elements and tools. Again, your website, you want to make sure you've got some listings and review sites, social media, email, and then even some good content that you're going to be able to push out so that you can reach the right people. And then don't forget, You've got that ability to amplify your efforts using paid advertising. And then there's that Google Ads Grant Ads program that you can take a look at it and see if your organization is going to qualify to really help you push the word out. And last but not least, you really want to make sure that you're measuring your success, and that's going to allow you to take bigger strides with your communications into the new year. You want to understand what worked, what didn't, and that's going to allow you to communicate and continue to build those relationships that we've been talking about so much today. And again, that's going to allow people to share things and spread the word throughout the year as well. Michele, is there anything else that you'd want to leave the audience with today before we wrap up?
Actually, just something that occurred to me in one of those later slides too. You can use design as a planning tool. It's, you know, if you're doing a special campaign, you know, you can connect the design across the platforms to make your holiday, your year-end campaign look like it belongs with your organization, but as something distinctive, so that it's catching people's eye wherever they're encountering your message.
I love that idea. And something I think I forgot to mention, but I had put it in the notes and apparently I skipped over it, is, you know, if you've got that branding for your specific campaign, maybe it fits kind of along with your regular brand, but stands out to feature Giving Tuesday or whatever your campaign is about, you can change things, especially on social media, like your profile picture and even your bigger cover photos, to make sure that it features your campaign and really stands out a lot. So I really love your point about that. All right. So if you want to learn a little bit more from our wonderful expert, Michele, thank you again. You can actually sign up to join her email list and you'll get tons of really great marketing ideas. You're going to find the link in the resources to her website where you can sign up, or you can just type into your browser silverliningcom.com. And I do want to let you know that we are here to help. We've actually put together a page with tons of really great resources that are going to help you to power through the rest of 2020 so that you can capture these crucial year-end donations. Be sure to check out this page for more resources on your year-end fundraising. And if you don't already have a Constant Contact account, you can sign up for a free trial at the top of that page as well. I do want to thank you all so much for watching. And Michele, I want to thank you so much for sharing all of your great expertise with us.
Thank you for having me. As always, it's a pleasure. It's a lot of fun to speak with you guys.
It's been a pleasure, again, speaking with you as well. And I hope you all have a wonderful giving season and busy season. And I hope you have a great day. Thanks again, Michele.
Okay, thank you.
Bye.